Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi sami'i al-alim min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. من همزه ونفخه ونفثه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وبعد, dear brothers and sisters everywhere, welcome to a new edition of your program Ask Huda. Our contact informations are as follows, and they should appear on the screen as well. Area code for the phone numbers 002-0238-555-248 or 249. The email address is ask@huda.tv, and the Facebook account is msalahofficial@facebook.com. Without any further ado, I just had a very simple and fine inquiry yesterday from Brother Muhammad, our young viewer yesterday. He was reading in Surah Al-A'raf in verse 176 and the following verse, a story. وَأَتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَوِينَ. Then in the following ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an example or a parable to that, with a dog lolling out his tongue. So he's asking about the similarity or وَجْهُ الشَّبَه. In Arabic, when we have mushabbah and mushabbah bih, something that you give an example to another thing, it does not necessarily mean that they are identical. Not necessarily even in the most prominent features, but in one of the features. The first ayah is talking about a story. One of Bani Israel, he was a scholar, and people used to resort to him in order to ask him to make dua for them, because his dua was mustajab. Allah used to answer his supplication, and he was a very righteous person. In many narration, his name was Bal'am or Bal'am from Bani Israel. And one story says that Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, sent him to a king, and the king tempted him, and he gave him plenty of wealth and so on, and he changed. So he withdrew. That is the meaning of فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا. Yani he withdrew from the ayat, the signs, and the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if he did not study any of them, as if he did not receive any of them. So after he was rightly guided, what happened? There was an intikasa. He went back on his heel, and he withdrew from the ayat and the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when this happens, it is expected that a shaytan will take over. And this is exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَوِينَ. When he withdrew from the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right away the shaytan took over and controlled him. And eventually he became among those who went astray. The ayat go on, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the following ayah, فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ. The example of this person, whether Bal'am or any other person, who is rightly guided, who recognized the truth. As the Prophet ﷺ said about certain person, he has accepted faith by his tongue, وَلَمْ يُؤْمِنْ قَلْبُهُ. He knew the truth only by the tongue. He's very fluent, he's very outspoken. If he gives a lecture, he may guide others, may cause them to cry and shed tears. But inside his heart, he's not rightly guided. فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ. The parable or the similitude of this person is like a dog. In what sense? إِن تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكْهُ يَلْهَثْ. Whether you drive him away, you know, when there is a stray dog and you try to attack him or kick him away, when you drive him away, he lolls out his tongue. The word يَلْهَثْ is to gasp for air. When the person is running, so the person or the human being would only do that when he's running, when he's jogging, when he's making an effort. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ forbade rushing to attend the prayer. Because when he was leading the prayer once, some person ran in order to catch the Prophet in ruku', and he kept gasping for air like this. That's called lahath. So the Prophet ﷺ forbade that. But that happens occasionally with men whenever they make an effort. But with dogs, they're constantly yalhas and lolling out his tongue. Whether you attack him or you don't. Whether you leave him alone or you drive him away. So he's always looking for something. This person who withdrew from the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always looking for dunya. Is always looking for the least. Is always after his desire, whims and temptation. He's trying to satisfy his lust by any means. He will never be satisfied. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ. Because with the knowledge and with the guidance, he was elevated. But when he withdrew from this guidance, he was sent down by his choice to al-ard, to the lowest of the low. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Nadia from the case. Assalamu alaikum.
Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, I have a question about beard because there is a little dispute between me and my husband. I want to ask, this is a question actually from him, that is it fard or sunnah? And if a person doesn't have beard, is he a sinful person? Because he doesn't have, and I'm forcing him to keep it, and from 3-4 days he didn't shave. But today he was telling maybe I will shave today. So I wanted to answer this question because I asked him to watch the program just now.
Yeah,
so
okay.
Is it mandatory or it is only sunnah? That if he will not keep it, is he sinful? And my second question, I asked it before in any other program, but Sheikh didn't answer me that time. And he told me later on, but up till now I didn't get the answer. So I want to ask you that Sheikh, I think he told about the shayateen that they are spread over after Maghrib. So he said that Maghrib to Isha, don't leave your kids alone. So I wanted to ask you that if my son is going to the prayer for Maghrib prayer alone, because my husband is at work that time. So what should I do? He's 9.5 years old.
Okay.
So I have to keep him home or I have to send him.
Okay.
And my third question, that if husband and wife both will go to paradise, but they are on the different levels, so how they will be, husband and wife, how they will live together there? I mean, in Jannah, they are on the different levels. And my last question about that, if the children, they are so small and they are doing some good deeds, for example, my daughter, she's only 2 years old and she's praying, mashallah, all the prayers with me and ruku and everything she's doing practically, but of course she doesn't know the prayer. She's only 2 years old. So when she will grow up, will it record it in her good deeds after when she will become baligh, I mean? Because now she's only 2 years old. So I think she doesn't have any record books. So I want to explain these questions for me. Thanks a lot for your answers.
You're most welcome,
you
Sister Nadia. Barakallahu fiki. Brother Amir from United Arab Emirates.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, I have 3 questions and I will quickly ask them. The first question is related to wudu. If someone is performing wudu and they forget one rukun, for example, they forget to wipe the head, and they move on to washing the feet, and then remember that they, you know, they didn't wipe their head. What should they do? Should they perform the wudu all over again, or just wash their head?
Okay.
The second question is about praying in one's native language. So, for example, can while in the prayer and in the sujood, can we make a dua in non-Arabic language? So, could it be in English or Urdu or Hindi, whatever? That's the second question. And the third question is, what is the authenticity of Prophet's hadith?
The authenticity of what hadith?
No, Prophet's hadith.
Authenticity of Salat al-Tasabih. Okay. Naam. I got your question.
Okay.
Barakallah fiq, Amir. Jazakallah khayran. We have Sister Yusra from Kenya. Assalamu alaikum, Yusra.
Alaikum assalam, Sheikh. I have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I met this guy online, and he wants, I've known him for a long time, but we haven't had any like, extramarital sex or something like it.
Any affair? Okay?
Uh-huh.
You haven't had any affair with him, but you know him, like...
Yeah.
You go out with him? So. You go out with him and you date him?
No, I haven't. I haven't. He wants to come to my family and meet my family.
Mm.
And he wants to revert to be a Muslim. He's not a Muslim. He wants to revert. But I explained this to my mom. And she doesn't think it's a good idea. She doesn't want him, actually. But I feel like he's the only person. He understands me a lot in many ways.
Mm.
Because when I was young, I kind of got molested from my family members.
Mm.
And it's kind of hard for me to trust people from my family, and especially people from my ethnicity. So now I'm confused. I don't know. I haven't talked to my dad yet. I haven't told him. And so I'm confused now. I don't know what to do.
Yeah. First of all, Sister Yusra, thank you so much for trusting me with this question. Second, I perfectly understand what it means, and I could feel the pain that you are in due to the horrible experience of child molestation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen your iman, and may Allah punish those who have put you in this situation. But you have to move on. When the person tries to bring on to his memories the bad experiences, he still lives in that misery when he tries to overcome this by forgetting and forgiving. Of course, if it is possible to bring the person to the proper punishment by law, I would do that. But if it is not possible, then at least your dad should be aware of that, so this person would not be allowed into your house. And also the whole family would be aware of this person, because if this person has this kind of sickness in his mind, he may as well try with other kids. So one thing can make you feel better is by trying to protect other youngsters from this evil person by conveying your story to those who are in charge. If your father can do something about it, I highly adjure you that you should inform him with the details in order to protect you and protect others and alert the whole community, not just the family, again, is this evil person. Number two, with regards to the man whom you trust so much, but he is not a Muslim and he wants to become a Muslim, I don't want you simply to move from a bitter experience to another more bitter experience. Why? Because when you say he's the only person whom I trust, and you think that he's the only person who understands you, as human beings, we may think whatever we think. But by the end, if I would like to make a decision, I should consult Allah, who knows best, who knows better than your dad, better than you, yourself, and anybody else. That's why the Prophet, peace be upon him, prescribed for us the istikhara prayer. And we only pray istikhara pertaining permissible matters. Like if a gentleman wants to propose to me, and he's okay, excuse me, he prays, he fasts, he doesn't drink, and he's just an ordinary person. In this case, I pray istikhara. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows this person will be the best for me, or I'll be the best for him, and we'll have the best life together. Allah knows, he will direct me. But when somebody proposes to me and he drinks, and you say, I pray istikhara, no, don't pray istikhara, because Allah is not pleased with that to begin with. Okay, somebody is very nice, well-mannered, blah, 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 but he does not pray, and he's proposing to me. Forget about it. Not even to pray istikhara, because the guy does not pray. Okay, when it comes to a person who is not Muslim, it's very risky that the person says, I would like to become a Muslim. I'm telling you, as an older brother, from many experiences that I have, in the West particularly, many people have come to me and said that I would like to become a Muslim. The thing is, some of whom were honest enough to tell me that I would like to become a Muslim because I'm in love with this girl in Malaysia, in Indonesia, Pakistan, or wherever. I've known her over online, or I was deployed there and I got to meet her. She was my secretary. And her family would not let me marry her unless if I become a Muslim. So his sole purpose of accepting Islam, just to get the certificate for me in order to facilitate his marriage. This is not Islam, and this marriage is invalid. If the person chooses to accept Islam, whether you accept to marry him or not, then he starts practicing the religious practices and so on his own, then he is a Muslim. Afterward, I may consider his proposal. But when I make up my mind from the beginning that this man is the best for me and he's not even a Muslim, you're moving to the worst experience, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تُنْكِحُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنُوا. Don't give your daughters or the girls who are under your guardianship to non-Muslims in marriage under any circumstances. Let me just take a few phone calls and I will get back to the same point, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Muhammad from United Arab Emirates.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Barakallah feek, Muhammad.
Yes, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you people for all the effort and work you guys are doing.
Ameen. And you too. Barakallah feekum.
Yes, I have three questions here.
Nah.
Now, the first is in regards to zakat.
Now.
Nah. Okay, what does a person do when his money is in like three places? He has borrowed some people his money, and of course he has a few also in the bank. Does he calculate all of it when he wants to give out the zakat, or what is the saying on that?
No.
That's one. Second question is in regards to Sitta Shawwal. How do you pray Sitta Shawwal? Do you do it continuously after Ramadan, as in on an everyday basis, or do you do one today and you rest the next day and you do another one?
Yeah.
That is also another question. And the third question is, how do you answer a non-Muslim when he says, Assalamu alaikum to you?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I mean, sometimes you see non-Muslims, they go, they say, Assalamu alaikum to you. And I would like to know how you respond to that.
Yeah, sure.
That's
okay.
It, yes. Jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakum barakallahu fiqh.
Yes,
Brother Omar from United Arab Emirates.
Finally, I got you.
Yeah, Omar.
Thank you so much. Please, I want you to clarify this issue of foreign exchange.
Foreign exchange. But we didn't get the question, though. Try again, please. Okay. You know, if the viewers allow me, because Sister Yusra's case is not a singular case. Many, many families of those who are sitting and watching me right now may have a similar case with any of their daughters, or God forbid, they may have it in the future. So we have to learn how to deal with things like that. I met some families, like a woman, for instance, of the many, many cases I'm talking about in upstate North America. She was married to this guy. Initially, said, okay, I would like to become a Muslim. But he only married her in order to, and he only accepted Islam in order to marry her. Okay, he married her. Then what's next? After he married her, he did not practice any Islam. And she had many children from him. The children do not know whether they're Muslims or Christians or atheists, because the woman is torn apart. The woman she comes to the masjid, to the center regularly, and every Ramadan I see her, because I visit only in Ramadan, and she's fasting and everything. But she's torn apart. The community is accusing her of adultery because she is living with a non-Muslim. And the guy declares that he's not a Muslim. She says his heart is good and he would like to be, but now it's been 20 years. He did not really practice Islam. Okay? He only declared it in order to marry this woman. But afterward, he is not a Muslim. Would you like to be in a situation like that? You're trying to escape from some bitter experience to another misery. And there is another very important thing, which is, as we were students in college, in high school, and anywhere, when a person talks to a girl, even those who are chatting online now, and he says some sweet words to the girl, because it's natural, Every boy would like to speak sweet to a girl, and the girl would take these words as if he only speaks to her like that, because he's obsessed about her love, and she's his queen, and he doesn't think about anything in life but her, and so on. Then she started building her own castle in dreams, of course. Okay, until she stuck with the reality. This is normal. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, whenever a man and a woman who are not related to each other, they're not husband and wife, they're not mahram, are together behind closed doors, they're not alone. The third is a shaitan. The explanation is a shaitan will make this woman, who may be an older woman with wrinkles, he will make her the most beautiful woman in his eyes. And the opposite is true. Why? In order to seduce them both, so that they will fall into the sin. A girl who wants to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and wants to guarantee happiness in this life before the hereafter, wants to have a beautiful family and beautiful children who will be righteous and pray for her after this life, then whenever somebody proposes to me, we have to find out his akhlaq, his religious commitment, and how long he's been practicing, and so on. Also, his earning, halal or haram. Many people, when somebody walks in and he's a bank manager, wow, mashallah, he's a bank manager, he makes a bunch of money. Okay, it's all from haram. How good is that? He's a nice looking guy, he's pretty tall, and he drives BMW or whatever. All of that is nothing. As a matter of fact, is a curse. كل جسد نبت من سحت فالنار أولى به. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا جاءكم من ترضون دينه وأمانته فزوجوا. A friend of mine, a couple months ago, heard me was talking about this, and somebody proposed to his daughter. And the guy was working for a bank, a big time bank in one of the Gulf countries. And he was shocked when the family told him, sorry, we don't give our daughter to somebody who earns haram, but in a nice way, yani. So because he was very interested in the girl, he worked hard, he quit the job and he found a halal job with a better income, and now they're about to get married. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this family and this girl a reason for the repentance of this person. And you know how Umm Sulaym, she was also the mother of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu. Umm Sulaym is a marvelous woman. I highly advise every person to read about Umm Sulaym tonight. She was the mother of Anas ibn Malik, and she was the wife of Abu Talha. Abu Talha was not a Muslim. When she accepted Islam before her husband, who was the father of Anas, he was very angry, but she was teaching Anas how to say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, etc. And the father left, and he died, he was killed afterward. Then Abu Talha heard about her story and her strength, and she was a very special woman, so he proposed to her. But he was not a Muslim, so she refused. He kept proposing. Then she sat with him and said, Ya Abu Talha, you are a wise man. Tell me, for God's sake, how can you carve a statue by your own hand with such and such person is sitting all day carving the statue, and he end up praying to it and asking for it? Does it make any sense? She convinced him. And he said the Shahada, and he accepted Islam, and he became one of the greatest companions. They say that the greatest dowry ever was the dowry of Umm Sulaym, because the dowry was making that person accept Islam, but accept it truly, not superficially, in order to marry her. May Allah bless you, sisters. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Zahra from the USA, assalamu alaikum.
Hi, hello,
sir. Yeah.
Arabic is not my native language, and I want to learn the Quranic Arabic. So, if I recite the
Quran, the meaning should be
immediately
coming to my mind. Is there any place where you can advise it so I can learn the Quranic Arabic myself? Yeah, inshallah. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much.
You're most welcome, Sister Zahra. Thank you so much. I just like to write, not to forget the questions. Okay, I want to go back to Moose from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. My question is that I've heard a hadith that one of the good things to have in life is a big house and maybe a good mode of, a sound mode of transportation. Could you please tell me about this hadith?
Yeah, sure. It's a very interesting hadith. I will discuss it, inshallah, with you. The three things that the Prophet ﷺ said, it's a sign of the blessings that the person may receive in this dunya. Okay. Zakum Allah khair. Okay. Sister Nadia from the KSA, about the beard. It's very lovely that the wife is very keen that she wants the husband, the youngsters, and everybody not just to enter Jannah, to be in the highest ranks in paradise. And she's also inquiring about what if somebody is in a higher rank, what will happen? The question, the three questions of Sister Nadia really pleased my heart so much. And brother, Sister Nadia's husband, may Allah bless you. Alhamdulillah, you're lucky you have a wife who wants to take your hand and go to paradise. So please, as long as Alhamdulillah she is advising you to do something that is prescribed by Allah and His Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then why not do it? With regards to the beard, is it sunnah or fard? The dispute between you guys, is it sunnah or fard? Okay. What about if I take you out of this dispute and I say, set aside sunnah or fard now, I will discuss it in a moment. But let's say it's a sunnah. Let's say it's something that the Prophet ﷺ used to do it. How much do you love him? Wouldn't you like to look like the Prophet ﷺ? Wouldn't you? Has the dispute between us become only whether it's a sunnah or fard? It shouldn't be the way. Did the Prophet ﷺ do it? Yes. Did he order us to do it? Yes. Then I will do it right away. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبَكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, test your followers. Do you love Allah? Everybody would say yes. Sister Nadia and your husband, you'll be the first to say, yes, I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask your husband, do you love Allah? Of course I love Allah. How much? I love Him so much more than myself. You sure? Are you sure that you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than yourself? Okay, let's take this test. فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Follow me. Follow the Prophet ﷺ in his way of living, the way he used to eat, the way he used to drink, the way he used to deal with people in business transaction, in marriage, in divorce, in fulfilling what Allah commanded, in abstaining from what Allah prohibited. That is a sign of the true love, that if you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, away from the dispute, you should follow the Prophet ﷺ, even if you consider it sunnah. Discussing any matter of the Prophet ﷺ, whether it's a sunnah, emphatic or non-emphatic, and whether the restriction is disliked or haram, is a sign of weak iman. Surprise. When a person discusses, okay, is it really haram or just makruh? Why? Because if it is makruh, then it's okay, I'll do it. That's a sign of a very weak iman. But when the person knows that the Prophet ﷺ did it, he doesn't ask right away, he does it. It's a sign of a strong iman and a sign of the strength of your love to Allah and His Messenger ﷺ. Now, the answer to the question, growing a beard is mandatory for men due to many, many ahadith. We may discuss some of them after the break. Stay tuned.
Do that because you do not know what to say to them sometimes. At least you raise up your hand and ask Allah, oh Allah, please give guidance to this brother of mine. The importance of following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To follow our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means you must understand his sunnah. Adino Yusrum, Islam is a very easy religion, simple religion. So don't make religion difficult to yourself. I believe this hadith is very common to all of us. But the beauty part of this hadith, number one, it started by Umar al-Qattab saying, Sami'tu. Now again, I'd like to share with the brother and sister to understand the beauty of this saying of the companion.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome, dear viewers from around the world, to our exciting program titled Good Answer. I'm your host, Malik, and I'm joined by the Imam of America, the founder of Guide Us TV. He needs no further introduction. I think you know who I'm talking about, Sheikh Yusuf Estes. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh Yusuf.
Assalamu alaikum, Malik.
My name is Ayman, and I think a lot of people would like to know, a lot of non-Muslims would like to know who Prophet Muhammad was.
We worship the God that he worshipped. Okay. And we worship that God the way he worshipped. So we consider Islam to be a way or a deen.
Right.
Anywhere. Anywhere. But that had never been done before. He said, this is a gift, never came before, that me and my followers, we can make our salah, our connection, anywhere.
Hey, sure, you're on the hot seat. I like my seat over here. I'm feeling comfortable. Because he asked you a tough question. He asked you a good question. Can you give him a good answer?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome back. As I say, there are many ahadith pertaining the obligation of growing the beard for a man. And that is a madhab of the four scholars, the founders of the four prominent schools of thoughts. Growing a beard is a wajib, some consider a fard, because there was no restriction or different explanation to the very obvious text when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَرْخُ الْلِحَى save the beards, and trim the mustache, وَأَحْفُ الشَّوَارِبْ, and many ahadith in this regard. So, brother, take your wife's advice, and sister Nadia, every time you see him growing his beard, say, you look much nicer now. You look very handsome. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautified men with. Imagine women shaving their hair. How would you look like? The beauty of a woman is in their hair. And the beauty of men is in their beards, as Aisha radiallahu anha stated before. Okay. With regards to if a person is in paradise in a higher level and his spouse in a lower one, the Quran says, أَلْحَقَنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ, we will make their offspring join them. وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, not the other way around. So the higher the person in a higher rank will not be downgraded in order to join his spouse or his family member or his offspring. Rather, they will be upgraded to join the one who is in a higher level. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ruhail from Kuwait. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, Shaykh. How are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Barakallahu feek.
It's a pleasure talking to you, Shaykh. I just have three questions, which I said two, but I just added one more.
Okay. Got it.
Sheikh, the one question I have is, when I go for prayer,
yeah,
and especially when I go to ruku, and because I'm 6'2", my height, so usually if I need to bend my back, I have to bend my arm as well. So
yeah.
Is it the correct way to go for ruku?
Yeah, bend your arms, no problem.
There's no problem.
Yeah.
And the
when you make ruku, when you make ruku', whether you're 6'3", I'm a little taller than you. When you make ruku', you have to make a right angle. As our teachers taught us, that if you put a glass of water, it will stand still because you're making a right angle. Those who make halfway ruku', this ruku' is incomplete. Second question.
Second question. The Sheikh, reading Quran in other languages.
Hmm?
If you read, I have seen some people, they read Quran, in their own languages without even reading in Arabic, and they think they believe that they get the same thawab, if you're reading in Arabic, is
okay.
Right?
Nobody really does. Those who do not know Arabic, they read the meaning of the Quran in their language, but nobody claims that it is the same. This is something very obvious. And meanwhile, when the person is trying to learn, I stated repeatedly the very fascinating hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ says, الماهر بالقرآن مع السفرة الكرام البررة, والذي يقرأ القرآن وهو عليه شاق ويتتعتع فيه فله أجران. One who recites the Quran fluently because Arabic is his mother tongue, his rank is with the purified scribes and angels. But the one who tries his utmost or her utmost to learn how to read the Quran and they're making an effort, they receive double reward. They receive double reward. So every person is invited to learn how to read the Quran and understand it even if they're non-Arab. As it is known to every person that the Arab represent a minority with regards to the Muslims population. 1.5 billion Muslims, about 18% of them are Arab, 350 or so, something like that. So every person should learn the Quran, especially that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran four times in the same chapter. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. Allah made the Quran easy to be remembered. That's why we have another question from Sister Zahra from the USA, who wants to learn how to read the Quran and so on. And is there a dua for that? A dua, you can make it in your own tongue. Oh Allah, make it easy for me to learn the Quran. There is no special prayer or a special act of worship that if you do it, then you will get up in the morning and you already know Arabic and you know the Quran or memorize the Quran as some believe or think. This is not true. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمِ. You can only become knowledgeable via or through seeking knowledge. When we go to the States, we meet people from various parts of the world. In Syria, they do not learn English. They learn medicine in Arabic. Pharmacology, mathematics, everything in Arabic. But as they travel there, and they have no English whatsoever, they want to practice medicine. They start from the scratch. They have a very high zeal and will that they have to become doctors or MDs there. Okay, so they learn English like beginners. Then they learn the terminology English in their field in pharmacology, and they become doctors and become successful in a matter of a few years. Why? There is a will, then there is a way. I would like to earn my provision as a doctor, so they learn English. People coming from Russia, coming from different parts of the world, learning how to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by reading the letter that He sent to us. The book that He delivered to us in Arabic should be a priority. Imagine there is no language on earth can describe the exact meaning of the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Arabic. And I explained that repeatedly in the program of correct recitation. Yes, you will be rewarded for merely learning the meaning of the Quran in any language. For sitting to study, tafakkur, learning the meaning of the Quran, you will be rewarded for that. But not as much or even close to reading the Quran in the same letter that it was revealed with. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam. Sister Fatima from the KSA, welcome to the program.
I have one question, please.
Yeah?
I pray Taraweeh in my home, so it is forbidden, or I have no idea about it, so can you explain it?
You pray Taraweeh at home, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Praying for women at home is superior, as far as the word, to praying in the masjid. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ said. As long as, alhamdulillah, you maintain your routine of praying, fine. The problem is if you feel a little bit lazy or overwhelmed with duties, housework, and you get distracted. In this case, I would say, go ahead and join your family members and go to the masjid. Barakallahu fiki, Sister Fatima. Any other questions?
No.
Okay. Nadia's daughter, she's only two, and she prays. This is a message for some families who have their daughters 16, 17, and 18. They are going out wearing very tight jeans, low-cut jeans, low-cut shirts, showing their bodies. You speak to the parents, "Yeah, Sheikh, she's a little young. She's a young girl. What are you talking about? She's still very young. She's already a full-grown-up woman. But she looks at her like it's too early to talk to her about hijab. It's too early to tell her to fast. It's too early to remind her about the prayer." The Prophet ﷺ said, "Allimu awladakum as-salata li sab'a." So the actual teaching of how to pray, like, you know, what to read and what to do if you forget anything, and what to say ruku and sujood, the details at the age of 7. Yes, the person is not required to officially offer the fara'id of the prayer of hajj or of fasting until reaching the age of puberty. But whatever good deeds the person, especially al-mumayyiz, who knows what he or she is doing, even if they are under the age of puberty, 6, 7, 8, 9, they will be rewarded for that, if that ibadah was offered properly. You're a child who's only 2 and prays next to you and so on, inshallah azajal, as they become 7 and 8, perhaps they will finish memorizing the entire Quran, and they will know more than the parents do by the age of 10 and 12, if they were given to the proper tutors. Barakallahu fiki. Amir from United Arab Emirates. Somebody is making wudu and forgot one pillar. Okay? He finished his feet and he forgot to wipe over his head. Can he just wipe over his head? No, you can't. Why can't I? Because in ayah number 6 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ then وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ then وَأَمْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ then وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ means wash your feet إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ. So the order was mentioned in the Quran in ayah number 6 of Surah Al-Ma'idah. You cannot do it otherwise, or one before the other. So the order in the wudu is a fard, exactly similar to washing each part of these parts which were mentioned in the ayah. So what to do if I washed my legs and I totally forgot to wipe over my head? So if I'm still wet because of the wudu, standing before this thing, so I would wipe over my head, then wash the feet again. So the first washing was invalid. I neglected. I wipe over the head and wash the feet. I mean, you have to follow the same order as it was mentioned in the Quran. Dua, making dua in your prayer in other than Arabic language, it is permissible, whether in sujood or otherwise. Okay? Only the adhkar which are prescribed in Arabic must be recited in the language. Subhana rabbiya al-azim, subhana rabbiya al-a'la, or making takbir, or rabbana wa laka al-hamd, etc. But in your sujood, you're most welcome to make dua in your mother tongue. Salatu al-tasabih is disputed whether it's valid or invalid due to judging the hadith which is narrated by Al-Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him. Many of the scholars used to offer it of the earlier, and many of the scholars judge the hadith as weak or even fabricated, and accordingly they do not rely on the weak hadith in establishing an act of worship. If you do it, still, inshallah, it is valid. But I like, in my religious practices, to rely on sound references, especially there are many, many, many other alternatives that you can fulfill or fill your time with regards to the nawafil. We answer Sister Yusra already, and I hope, inshallah, my advice will benefit you, and please follow up with me. I would like to know what have you decided, and you can take my email address or the phone number from the control, Sister Yusra. I'm paying close attention to your case. Muhammad from United Arab Emirates. Zakah, with regards to a loan that he has taken. Why did he take the loan? In order to pay some payments due on you or past due on you, then there is no zakah on that. You've taken a loan in order to buy some goods to sell them, there is zakah on that. You added them and you put them in your account for future investment, you pay zakah on that. You give somebody a loan, you pay zakah on that as long as the loan is expected to be collected. Fasting the 6 days of Shawwal, should they be consecutive? No, not necessarily. You can scatter them throughout the 29 or the 28 days of the month of Shawwal. Why not the 30? Because the first day is haram to fast on the Eid day. So you may begin fasting as early as the 2nd of Shawwal all the way to the end. It's easier though to begin as early as the 2nd day because you have the routine of fasting, so it will not be much of a burden for you. When somebody, a non-Muslim, says Assalamu alaikum, I would tell him Wa alaikum or Wa alaikum assalam, no problem. But I would limit it to just replying back to the same answer, no problem. I guess we answer most of all the questions. The hadith, I know that we went over time, the hadith of Sister Moose from United Arab Emirates. It is collected by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, and it is a sound hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, مِن سَعَادَةِ ابْنِ آدَمَ الْمَرْأَةُ الصَّالِحَةُ وَالْمَسْكَنُ الصَّالِحُ وَالْمَرْكَبُ الصَّالِحُ. Unfortunately, I cannot go any further, but inshallah I'll explain that in the next episode. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech, keep in my heart your remembrance and your